Presence in this place. I feel and see an unseen presence. I'm going to use simple math here, but in this room, right this second, is approximately 1,500 years of life experience, knowledge, and wisdom. Breathing, thinking, seeing, feeling, right here, right now. That is incredible. Ward and Susan and I used to be part of an organization called the International Association of Printing House Craftsmen. And the motto of that organization was share your knowledge. We were all competitors in a way, all printers, but we shared our knowledge to improve the quality of the industry, of the product, of the services that we presented to the public. And I'd like us to think this morning, we've got 1,500 years of experiences and knowledge and wisdom. Can we focus on sharing what we've learned for the purpose of improving the quality of the lives of those around us? I think that's such an asset, such a gift, such an abundance, and we don't think about it that much in that particular perspective. So it's the unseen that is seeable. And so it is. Now, come on up, John. You can just put those anywhere. I have the wonderful fortune. Okay, there we go. It's art. That's excellent. We all have something to share. Anyway, today, Sylvan Eidelman and Debbie Knapp are going to play some special music for us. And today is Juneteenth. And Debbie's going to tell you about the man that did this song. Debbie, tell us about this. Very appropriate song.
Well, when a jazz pianist that I've always loved is Oscar Peterson. He was famous for his fast fingers and technique, but he wrote a very important piece called Hymn to Freedom, and it was for the civil rights movement in the 60s, and it became the anthem for the marches during that time, and it has remained an anthem for civil rights. So Sylvan and I are playing this for the first time.
For Juneteenth.
For Juneteenth.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And just so you might be able to put some dots together, you've heard me talk about this amazing band called Take Your Medicine. Sylvan is the violinist in that. And he plays the violin and the fiddle sometimes at the very same time. Today he's going to play the violin and the viola, not at the same time. Thank you very much. Today is also Father's Day, and a happy Father's Day wherever it might be appropriate. And today we're doing something very special. Bonnie has asked that we honor her father, and there's a wonderful story about her father, and Kelly's going to read it for us. Kelly?
Good morning. Yeah, happy Father's Day to all the fathers here. You know, I think, at least I know several of my friends and I, we woke up, I was thinking about my own dad. And then I got to read about Bonnie's, and I think you'll enjoy this. This is a story of Tom Dixon, and his picture is right there. The date, August 6th. 1901, the setting, a small sod shanty on the plains outside Rock, North Dakota. The event, a son is born to John Benjamin and Elizabeth Jane Dixon. They name the baby John Thomas, but he soon is to be known by all as Tom. Growing up, up on a farm, young Tom worked the fields with his brothers and alongside his father, learned to care for their sick and injured animals, as well as those of neighbors and friends. The work was hard, the hours long, but in later years, the memory of his mother's cooking, her roast goose and plum pudding were just an example, and their ample life were to help them sustain young Tom in the harder years that followed. Now, he was not always a good child, although his mother thought him rather special. She forbade the golden curls of his babyhood to be removed for a long, long time. Tom took pleasure in teasing his sisters and arranging practical jokes. At the age of 16, he ran away from the farm, and his sister Myrtle can remember his father having to go after him, and their mother waiting at home with the buggy whip in hand. But by the time he returned, however, she was so glad to see him that he even got a new pair of shoes, a rare commodity in those times. Just a short year later, Tom was to accompany his mother to the home of his sister and her family in Rolette, North Dakota. As it happened, his sister had an occasional babysitter, a young school teacher from Montana, one Miss Edith Davis. As love would have it, young Tom was quite smitten with this pretty young girl and went to work on a cement crew in Rolette just to stay for the summer. He returned to Roth that winter, but his mind and heart were in Rolette with Edith. Early the following spring, he returned, and against the wishes of his family, for they thought that at 19 he was much too young, he proposed to her. They married in Rolla, North Dakota on March 25th, 1920. Tom and Edith began their life on the family farm, but soon moved out to share a farm with his brother. Tom and his brother worked on a threshing crew and traveled all over the countryside, working other people's farms, going as far away as Kansas looking for work. While Tom and Edith's marriage was not immediately blessed with the luxury or wealth, it was definitely blessed with children. In the years that followed, there would be 8 in all, although only 6 would survive infancy. Edith bore the first 2 at home with only a midwife in attendance, and Tom was a very nervous father. He was sent to the farm each time, to the barn each time to await the outcome. With very little money and a not too prosperous farm, and with all those mouths to feed, Tom and Edith, like millions of others, found themselves in the midst of the Depression. Tom found work where he could and held the family together. Edith made head cheese for his lunches, and they ate 8 canned sardines and potato soup, but they survived. The years passed quickly, and their growing children soon married and began to disperse throughout the country. With the war on, both of Tom and Edith's sons, as well as his sons-in-law, enlisted in the service, taking them farther away from home. On a trip to California to visit one of the daughters, Tom went to work in the shipyards for the Army Corps of Engineers. Not totally convinced that California was their dream home, Tom and Edith took the youngest child and headed for home. With no farm work to go back to, they settled in a town where Tom worked odd jobs doing roofing and painting, but soon Edith's itchy feet took over and they were on their way back to California. Tom went to work at Fiber Ray, a concrete plant, making and installing the dividers on the ever-growing freeways in and around the Bay Area. They settled in Mill Valley, where they were close to their daughter and her family. Soon the rest of the children and their families settled in the Bay Area, and their baby, Bonnie, married and moved away. Left alone once again with the family close at hand, Tom and Edith spent many hours with their grandchildren and had many memories of the large family gatherings. Tom retired from Fiber Ray, and he and Edith finally settled in Cotati, California. Tom got a job as a janitor at Wass School in Petaluma, working there for several years and making many friends. He was remembered by many of the children who attended the school. During this time, Tom and Edith succumbed to what he liked to call Edith's itchy feet, and enjoyed taking trips to nearby lakes to fish and camp. They also made many a trip back to North Dakota and to Montana to visit relatives and friends. It is the opinion of at least one family member that Edith's itchy feet or not, Tom enjoyed the traveling an awful lot himself. As the years went by, Tom and Edith spent more time at home, and Tom finally retired from the schoolhouse. They tended a large garden each year, and Tom took care of the constant influx of animals brought to Grandpa by his grandchildren. Wimpy, their little dog, followed them everywhere. The family came and went as usual, and Grandpa's was always a good place to run across a cousin or two on a Sunday afternoon. On March 23, 1975, Edith passed away after a lengthy illness, leaving only Tom and Wimpy to take care of their home. She is missed to this day by all those who knew and loved her, but especially by Tom. Today, Tom is once again traveling, having made a cross-country trip 2 years ago and a trip to Alaska last year. He is, in his 80th year, a vital man, still the center of his family. His legacy of children, grandchildren, and great-children can be rivaled by few. A simple, modest man, he led a quiet, simple life, an honest life, and he is loved by all. Thank you, Bonnie, for sharing your father with us.
Thank you. How fortunate you are to have such a legacy and such a great memory of your dad. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I think summer is going to catch us here in a day or two. It's supposed to get very warm again shortly. Anyway, this week, invite all of you to join us after the service for fellowship next door in the hall. Then next Saturday morning, or Saturday at noon, Cotati is having the Cotati Music Festival down in the park from 1 until 6. But the most important thing that's going to happen next Saturday is Church of the Oaks is having the cabaret, community cabaret at the Oaks, from 5 until 7 right here in the hall with Lori V and the Jazz Band. And there's posters in the back. Bonnie, take some of these over to 42 Charles Street and stick them up. Anybody else, take them and put them somewhere. They're on the table in the back. And that's Saturday. Then Sunday, we're having potluck right after church. And for some of the people on the board, next Saturday morning at 8 o'clock, we're going to get together and do inventory stuff for the potluck. We're going to unload the storage room and see what we have and what we don't have, or for the pancake breakfast, see what we have and what we don't have. So that's Saturday at 8 o'clock for a few people. Yes, Joan.
This Thursday, 10 o'clock, spiritual book group in the
Okay, in the hall? Okay, this 10 o'clock this Thursday, spiritual book group. Any other announcements? The pancake breakfast will be June or July 9th. And it's just, we'll hear more about it, but circle that day on your calendar. We'd love you here from early in the morning till noon, if you can be here.
And just a reminder, tonight at 7:15 here in the sanctuary, healing.
Okay, that continues, and thank you for doing that.
Next Sunday's
potluck. And Joelle, you?
No, I'm just trying to
know. Thank you. Okay. Oh, and I'd like to remind everybody, get your Gazette, page 39. We are in there. Wayne talked about it last week, and I'd like to thank Wayne and everybody who stepped in last week to cover my absence. I really enjoyed the day off very much. So, without further ado, seems like, anyway, in this very room, number 22 in the songbook, let's all stand and sing that.
And there's quite enough for all, and quite enough for all.
Now we may greet each other in whatever fashion might be comfortable for you.
That was very nice, guys.
I spoke earlier about this wonderful abundance that we have of roughly 1,500 years of experience and knowledge and wisdom. Well, there's all types of abundance. Debbie is going to teach us something this morning that might just be fun. And you can laugh if you want, but she laughs. But anyway, this is another facet, another awareness of abundance. Debbie?
This is something from my musical journeys and experiences that a choir that I work with. It's called, it's not called anything. And I looked up the origins of it. It is from a rabbi, a singing rabbi. So if you'd like to stand, that would help. It has some hand motions to it. So I'll do it first. You I receive, to you I give. Together we share, from this we live. So you grab your part, your neighbor's hand, from this we live. So let's try it, and we'll do it like two times. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, from this we live. Good. Hey. Yeah. You guys are fast learners. One more time. From you I receive, to you I give. Together we share, from this we live.
Well, that's nice. Thank you, Debbie. Thank you very much.
That's just profound. And it doesn't have a name. It's not called anything. We'll call it Debbie's Wisdom. Let's read together, if we will, please, the affirmation of abundance. Isn't it ironic how the darkness that encompasses the life of one who has lost everything can actually be the illumination of our awareness of the vast abundance we have and the countless ways in which we may share that abundance. May we ponder that a moment. Let's sing together as we prepare ourselves for a time of practice in the stillness, number 97 in the wings.
Just savoring this turnout. Holy moly, it's like amazing. Twice as many people as I've ever seen here. It's wonderful. it's great. But, you know, we've already had a couple of practices so far, so we're going to keep it short and sweet today. We've done this one once before, but it's been a while. And it's kind of a visualization where you imagine, in honor of, you know, the summer solstice is coming up in a day or two, we're just going to really call in that beautiful, big, bright sun of energy that carries exactly what we need right now. And we're going to visualize that sun of energy above our heads and pull it down into our energy field. You can, if you can do this physically with your arms, that's great. If your shoulders won't allow that, you can just imagine it or just go this high, whatever's available to you. So let's just start by taking a couple deep breaths. Just getting ourselves a little more centered in the present here. And now see that big, bright, beautiful sun floating above your head with all the divine wisdom and energy and healing that you might need within it. And just go ahead and either physically raise your arms or imagine that you're doing it. If you're doing it physically, see if you can almost feel that ball of energy. It might make your hands move a certain way. It's really there if you believe it is. When you're ready, you can drop it down into your field. Just pull it gently down, all the way to your feet. And one more time, just seeing another bright, beautiful sun full of divine healing and energy. And just guiding it down through your head, through your heart, your solar plexus, your root chakra, all the way down through your feet. And one more time for good measure. Big, beautiful sun above your head, just gently take it, pull it down, thanking it for giving you exactly what you need. So it is. Namaste.
Thank you.
much. Just, I play music with Sylvan all the time, and it's just, I'm in awe constantly. He never has music, he just closes his eyes and plays. It's just amazing. Thank you both. Well, I spoke of it earlier, this 1,500 years of combined experience and knowledge and wisdom. I heard a lady speak, and her name is Ashton Applewhite. And she is an activist against ageism. And I listened to her and I thought, I'm a pretty positive guy. You know, I look for solutions to problems, and that kind of sounds negative a lot of times, but I shame and devalue myself every day. And I think most of us do. Most of us in this room are mature. We could call it chronologically gifted, if you will. But how often do we use ageism against ourselves? You know, there's already enough discrimination about age in our society. That's just old people and young people. You know, we are reservoirs of vast knowledge and wisdom and experience. And our young people, these millennials, most of them are not mindless twits, as we are called, so they are called sometimes. But we catch yourself. I want to talk today about the purpose of all this is to for you to value yourself more. As we gain years, we don't lose value. Society thinks we do, but we don't. We increase in value. It's just how many times we misplace the keys. I'm having one of those senior moments. Gene, have you ever said that? Misplaced the keys and having one of the... Young people misplace their keys more than we do. Do we ever hear them going around complaining? Ah, I'm nuts, I'm having one of those junior moments. No. And this right knee of mine, I'm 74 years old. This right knee, old age is terrible. This right knee is killing me. Well, actually, the other knee is the very same age, I think, and it's fine. You know, we have so much to offer society. Look at the people in this room. Look at each other. Every one of you has different things to bring to the meeting, the party, the family, if you will. And we are forever devaluing each other. We got this thing about, I want you to look this lady up on YouTube or Google, Ashton Applewhite, Ashton Applewhite, all one word. She's amazing. And she talks about, we think about, well, this old age is time for gloom and doom, and this, we're in the twilight of life, but we just kind of be miserable, and it's gonna suck because we think it's gonna suck, and therefore it will. And she discovered this thing called the U-curve of happiness. And this is based on science, not opinion. And it looks like this. This is happiness. The highest levels of happiness are when we are in our childhood and when we are in our old age. From birth to death, that's the two best, happiest times of life. Middle age, not so much. And I got a whole bunch to talk about that middle age, not so much. I think that's when we begin to change from trying to accumulate stuff and make families to where we have to change our value system and change our lifestyles. Everything changes when we get middle age. The nest gets empty. The hair kind of sometimes falls out, some turns colors. A lot of changing going on, and that causes unrest and anxiety. But as we grow older, we have a whole new kind of courage, a whole new kind of confidence. We just don't care what people think. We always did up till that point, very concerned about what will people think. We don't care. We fool ourselves into thinking, oh, I'm going to get old and going to end up in a retirement home or a facility or something. The fact, right now, 5 years ago, 4% of people over 65 lived in senior living places. Today, it's 2.5% of people over 65. Over 85, it's only 5%. That's amazing. Just amazing. This lady, Ashton, wrote a book called This Chair Rocks. And it's all about an activist view of ageism. And all these isms, you know, we got racism and homophobia and sexism and all these different isms. Those are all made up theories by society. They aren't the truth. We hear so much, well, just think positive. Well, that's fine. But sometimes that can be a little airy-fairy too. How about as we grow older, we just think fact. What are the facts? The facts are we know so much more. We don't care what people think. We finally have some wisdom to figure out some of these mysteries of life. And don't think in fear. So much of our lives we spent worried about stuff. I heard somebody say the other day, worry was nothing but praying for bad stuff. And I think that's true. But when we get to this, what did I call it? To the stage of being chronologically gifted. We're happier. We are, it's a fact, scientific fact. We are happier. We know more. We are much more confident, much more fearless. So when you think about the abundance you have in your life, your person, your sum total of life experiences, thoughts, knowledge, and wisdom are a fountain of abundance. And society indigenous societies valued their elders, put them on a pedestal for their years of experience and knowledge and wisdom. And today we're much too concerned about being independent. Well, folks, to be happy, happiness is always based on our relationships that we have. Let's think about being interdependent. Yeah, driving and stuff like that, that's a type of independence, but it's interdependence. It's those friends, those family, those relationships. That's the beauty in life. That's the value. That's what you take with you no matter what dimension you're in your heart, in your soul, is what those relationships represented in your life. The love you shared, the compassion you shared, what you were able to learn. And like, I give to you, I receive from you, I give to you. just like what Debbie was saying. It's, this is what we live. It's just, value yourself. Each one of us is an amazing manifestation of spirit, of God, of harmony, of knowing. I think I've talked well long enough. Love you. Really love you. Value you. The ladies, on her talk, she said, it was a TED talk or something, she said, when you look in the mirror thinking, oh my God, what happened? Change that around, like, oh my God, what things, amazing things have happened in my life. I've not only survived, I've thrived. And I've earned every one of these wrinkles, every one of them. They're service stripes, and I'm proud of them. Love yourself and love each other. We are an amazing community. We are truly chronologically gifted, and so it is. Let's stand up now and sing What a Wonderful World, number something or other in the song book, 40.
Don't you want a little postlude?
No.